Right. Good morning, everybody. It's nice to see you again in our Zoomina series. Before we start, I would like to remind everybody about the early career opportunity to participate in our Zoomina series. We extended the deadlines for the application and submission of the abstracts to March 1st. So we have a couple, like about 10 days extension of the deadline. Please apply and spread the word about that possibility. It will be great to hear new researchers in early career researchers to present in a seminar series. For today's seminar, we will Dr. Collier will be introducing the speaker, and I'm just not going to delay anymore. Please, Dr. Collier, it's your turn. Thank you.
Thanks, Magda. Yeah, it's a great pleasure for me to join this seminar and to introduce today's speaker. That is Dieter Willbold. Dieter Willbold studied biochemistry in Tübingen and Bayreuth in Germany and in Boulder in Colorado. He completed his PhD in 1994 at the University of Bayreuth. After some years as assistant professor in Bayreuth and a couple of research visits, for example, to the Seckler School of Medicine of Tel Aviv University, in 1998, he was leading his independent junior research group at the Institute for Molecular Biotechnology in Jena, Germany. In 2001, Dieter became an associate professor for NMR spectroscopy of biological macromolecules at the Heinrich Heine University in Düsseldorf. Since 2004, he is full professor and chair of the Institute of Physical Biology in Düsseldorf, and in parallel, director of the Institute of Biological Information Processing at Forschungszentrum Jülich. His main interests are protein interactions with physiological and artificial ligands, high resolution structural biology, aging, neuropathic pain, autophagy, and amyloid diseases. Dieter has received several prizes, most recently the Innovation Prize of the German Biotech Regions for 2020. The focus of his work is the development of deenantiomeric peptides as therapeutics, especially for protein aggregation diseases. And I'm sure that he will tell us more about this approach in his talk, which has the title, A Beta Oligomer Disassembly into Monomers is Beneficial for Cognition and Memory in Transgenic and Non-Transgenic Alzheimer Animal Models. Please, Dieter, I'm looking forward to your talk.
Thank you very much, Wolfgang, for the nice introduction. And thank you, Rams, for inviting me to this really great series of lectures. Before I start, I would like to mention that for at least that's a message for Rams and for all the other NMR people in the audience, that the 1 GHz NMR is up and smoothly running at the Research Center Jülich.
Dieter, pardon me, can you use your headphone? Maybe the audio is going up and down. Thank you.
Hasn't been used for a while.
Yeah, it's working.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yep. Good to go.
Right. Before I I changed the title of my presentation a little bit only into a truly disruptive antibryonic treatment of Alzheimer's disease, but the content, of course, is the same. Here are my disclosures, and I will come back to this slide at the very end of my presentation. And as you all know, Alzheimer's disease is still an unmet medical need, and life age is the most important risk factor, and all the other things all of you will know. Now, A-beta certainly plays a decisive role in the development and progression of Alzheimer's disease. And when we look at the structures of A-beta, we have to remind ourselves that the structure of native A-beta monomers is intrinsically disordered. So the native A-beta monomer has an intrinsically disordered conformation. And the chemically identical molecule within an A-beta fibril structure, for example, here the structure solved by ourselves a couple of years ago, is totally different. Here in this fibril, the not only the backbone, but also the side chains are strongly ordered. And that's the only difference between toxic A-beta assemblies like fibrils and non-toxic A-beta monomers. So the only difference is the three-dimensional structure. Now, in order to understand a little bit better than, or to make the next few minutes a little bit easier, the IDP-like structure of monomers will be symbolized by a circle, and the structure of A-beta monomer building blocks within an A-beta fibril will be symbolized by a pentagon. And we all know that there are also A-beta oligomers around, and the structure of A-beta oligomers is not solved yet, but also in oligomers, A-beta building blocks will have a highly defined structure, and we symbolize it here by hexagons. Now, as all of you know, A-beta monomers are constantly formed throughout our lifetime from the amyloid precursor protein APP by beta and gamma secretases. And as I said, A-beta monomers are not toxic. And now this usual story would go like this, and A-beta monomers tend to aggregate, but actually that's not true. Under physiological conditions, that means one nanomolar A-beta or less, A-beta aggregation is a very rare event. You can sit in front of an Eppendorf tube with a one nanomolar A-beta solution and it will not aggregate, you can see, for years. So obviously A-beta aggregation is a kinetically highly disfavored event and therefore very rare. But for rare, and that's probably because the formation of the first aggregate is a high order reaction. That means that many, maybe at least six monomers have to assemble to make a minimal seed that is stable enough. But for rare things, and I will symbolize this only by three circles. For rare things to happen, you only have to wait long enough. And that's the most simple explanation why life age is the most important risk factor for Alzheimer's. And of course, the higher the A-beta concentration in the brain is due to, for example, familial mutations or trisomy 21, or due to environmental effects, the earlier in life this will happen in average. Most importantly, whenever this happens, the conformation of the building blocks change. And from now on, the situation is completely different, because from now on, single A-beta monomer building blocks will add to the oligomer. And this is almost independent from the A-beta monomer concentration, because that's a first order reaction. And this may explain why beta and gamma secretase inhibitors that are designed to reduce the formation of A-beta monomers by 20, 30, or maybe 40% had never a chance in the clinics with patients, but maybe preventively be quite effective, possibly. Oligomers can break off and again regrow further by a first order reaction, and that's nothing else than a prion. And whether we call it prion, prion-like, or prionoid, actually the patient doesn't care, because in his or her brain, toxic A-beta oligomers are self-replicating and propagating in the brain. And actually there are not so many solutions to treat or to target self-replicating etiologic agents. One option is to do an active immunization, but that's not really straightforward for a body's own protein. And the second option is to directly destroy or kill the etiologic self-replicating agent. And therefore, a couple of years ago, we have designed a compound called PreO2, and it is called in publications and some of the figures that you will see in a couple of minutes, also RD2. So PreO2 and RD2 are identical molecules. It is designed to stabilize A-beta monomers in their native IDP conformation. It is an all DNA enantiomeric peptide consisting of the amino acid residues. It is orally available, non-immunogenic, and it crosses the blood-brain barrier. Why did we use all D peptides for our drug development? Because the synthesis is quite easy and straightforward. There are hundreds of companies offering synthesis of peptides. And of course, if you use D amino acid building blocks, also D peptides, also in GMP quality. Because of their protease resistance, they can be applied orally, and there is a very low risk of off-target action because they are much more specific than really small molecules. And there are practically no risk for toxic metabolites because if degraded at all, the amino acid residue, the amino acids will be formed that are rapidly converted into L-amino acids, because for this we have enzymes, which are then go into metabolic or anabolic pathways. Now, this is a scheme, a very oversimplified scheme, how we imagine the mode of action of PreO2. As I said, PreO2 stabilizes A-beta monomers in their native IDP conformation. So when PreO2 interacts with an oligomer, it will interact with one of the monomer building blocks of the oligomer. And by interacting with this building block, it will push it towards its native IDP-like conformation. And this is incompatible with the oligomeric assembly, and it destabilizes the oligomer assembly. And for example, a second molecule of PreO2 attacks another building blocks, it will do the same with the other building block. The oligomer is further destabilized and finally destroyed into non-toxic IDP native A-beta monomer pieces. Now, this mode of action suggests three important properties. First of all, PreO2 should act highly cooperative. And actually, this it does act highly cooperative. For the chemists among you, we calculated the Hill coefficient of 3 for PreO2 by destroying A-beta oligomers. Also, it should act clearly sub-stoichiometrically. And we have shown this and published this end of 2019, that even at a stoichiometry of less than 1 to 10, it highly efficiently disassembles A-beta oligomers. And what we have not absolutely shown yet, but you will see later some first data on that, PreO2 is not consumed by destroying A-beta oligomers and thus can approach the next oligomer and thus acts catalytically. Now, I will show you some in vitro data that we have collected over the past years. And this is just to show you that that PreO2 interacts with A-beta monomers with a high affinity. So we found a KD value in the low nanomolar range. And we wanted to show that it really interacts with A-beta monomers and not with suddenly formed A-beta oligomers on the SBR chip. Therefore, we investigated also the interaction of PreO2 with A-beta monomers in analytical ultracentrifugation analysis. And without going too much into the details, we found really that that PreO2 interacts with A-beta monomers. And it does this also with non-1-to-1 stoichiometries. So if you over-titrate the complex, more than one PreO2 molecule will bind to A-beta. And vice versa, if you over-titrate PreO2 with A-beta, the same is true for this case. And this fits perfectly to the view that the both molecules, PO2 and A-beta, form a transient fuzzy complex. And this is also confirmed by NMR data. You see here an HSQC spectra of 15N labeled A-beta 42, a 40 micromolar concentration in black. And when you add 4 micromolar PO2 to the solution, there are no visible shifts in the peaks, which confirms that PO2 actually binds to the monomer and stabilizes it in its IDP-like conformation without changing anything of its conformation. And by titrating even further, the intensity of the peaks, of the cross peaks, is reduced. And this is also perfectly in line with the view that a fuzzy complex of 2 IDP-like peptides is formed. Now, more importantly, we wanted to know whether or how efficient RD2 or PO2 is by inhibiting the THT measured fibrillation of A-beta 42. And you see here the line in black, the aggregation of A-beta 42 with a 20 micromolar solution, and how decelerated the aggregation is in the presence of 1/10 or 1/20 of PO2 in the solution. So clearly, substoichiometrically, PO2 is decelerating the aggregation of A-beta. That means a clear effect on primary nucleation of A-beta. Now, this is a more complex figure, and you see here, hopefully, yes, in black, you see here the aggregation of A-beta 42. And you see when you add seeds, 1% only of A-beta seeds to it, the red curve here, how that there is no lag phase anymore, of course. And in the presence of 10% of PO2, this is highly decelerated. That's the green curve. And also, if you add even more seeds, 5% seeds, the blue curve here, this also is decelerated in the presence of 10% of PO2. So that means that there is also a very effective effect on elongation and secondary nucleation, whatever this may be. More importantly, because actually inhibiting something is easy, but destroying already pre-existing oligomers, that's a much tougher task. And therefore, we designed an assay that we called QUIET and published in 2015. And we showed this in 2017 for the PO2 compound that we do first an A-beta pre-incubation to allow the formation of oligomers. And only then we add agent or we don't as a control on the left side, and then carry out or put the sample onto a density gradient. And we carry out a density gradient centrifugation to separate the A-beta particles according to their size, roughly. And then we fractionate the content of the centrifugation tube and determine the amount of A-beta in each of the fractions. And in fractions 4, 5, and 6, we found the most toxic A-beta species, and those are A-beta oligomers. We characterized them. They are relatively homogeneous, but more importantly, the compound PO2 was able to drastically reduce the concentration of A-beta oligomers in fractions 4, 5, and 6. Now, one would have expected that the concentration of monomers in fractions 1 should have increased, but that's not the case, probably because that was done with 80 micromolar A-beta solutions. The solubility limit is just not allowing the increase even of A-beta monomers, and therefore we find amorph co-precipitates of PO2 and A-beta in fractions with very high molecular weight. But most importantly, all these co-precipitates are totally different from oligomers. They are thioflavin T negative, congruent negative, not toxic. And also very importantly, they are not able anymore to seed a better aggregation. Then we went into animal models and we used three different transgenic mouse models. The first one is APP Swedish London and the second one APP Swedish PS1. And for both mouse models, it is known that they develop blood pathology and cognition deficits. Both things are not necessarily connected to each other. And the third mouse model, TBA2.1, is expressing human pyroglu A-beta. And this is one of the very few transgenic A-beta mouse models that really develops neurodegeneration. And therefore, that was very interesting for testing our compound. And of course, we looked into blood pathology, but we were not interested to reduce any blood pathology. The only important readout for us was whether compound was able to improve cognition or to decelerate neurodegeneration. And for the cognition tests, how can you measure cognition? Many of you will know, but not all of you. There are several ways to measure memory and cognition of mice. And one of them is so-called Morris water maze. Basically, you have a water pool 1 meter in size. It is filled with turbid water, so the mice cannot see to the ground. And at one position just below the water surface, there is a platform. And if you then put the mouse into the pool, it will have to swim around and accidentally find the platform after a while. And it will sit there happily and safely. And therefore, the mice with a working memory will, after a couple of days of training, find the platform much faster than before the training. So you simply measure the time in seconds the mouse needs to re-find the platform. And that's shown here. In gray, you do see the transgenic mice with placebo treatment. And over the 6 days of training, they did not learn, whereas the PreO2 treated mice did very significantly learn. And the treatment here is the only non-oral treatment. We treated intraperitoneal over 4 weeks, and in the fourth week, we did the Morris water maze. So treatment was just 3 weeks. That's another treatment study, an oral treatment with 8-month-old APP Swedish London mice. The study was carried out at the CRO, and here also wild type was included. And you see the wild type mice in light grayish develop, learn significantly during the training period. The placebo transgenic mice in middle grayish did also learn, but significantly less. Whereas the PreO2 orally treated mice shown in black did very significantly learn and were indistinguishable from healthy wild-type mice. Here is another treatment study. Here we treated 18-month-old APP Swedish PS1 mice, and at the age they usually have full-blown pathology, no cognition, no memory. And we treated here over 12 weeks, again orally. And you see again here that in middle grayish, the transgenic placebo-treated mice did not learn over the training period, whereas in black, the orally treated transgenic mice did very significantly better and were again indistinguishable from healthy wild-type mice of the same age. With the same mice, we also carried out an open field test, and normally open field test is a very boring test. So basically, what you do in an open field test, you place the mouse in a box 40 by 40 centimeters in size. That's called arena, very dramatically. And then a camera system is evaluating how long the mice stay in the center of the box and how long in the edges and corners of the box. And that's just to check whether the mice behave like mice should behave, because they are anxious. They stay much less time in the center than in the edges and corners. And you see that all mice behaved like mice should. They are all anxious. Now, when you look in the lower part in how long the wild type mice stayed in the center, you see that there is a habituation behavior. And that's also very typically after a while, the mice learn that, oh, I was in the center, nothing happened to me, I can stay there longer. That's a habituation effect. But the transgenic placebo-treated mice do not have. They lost their habituation behavior. Obviously, they don't even remember what happened 2 minutes before, whereas the orally treated wild type, the orally treated transgenic mice were again indistinguishable from healthy wild type mice. So the treatment not only improved cognition, but also reversed the behavior of the mice. With these mice, we carried out also a target engagement in vivo. So we wanted to see whether the treatment led to a reduction of A-beta oligomers in the brain. And you certainly remember the scheme of the target engagement that we have just learned a couple of minutes before. And now we changed this kind of assay a little bit. Instead of using synthetic A-beta aggregates, we used brain homogenates of the placebo-treated mice and the pre-O2-treated mice. And we put the homogenates on top of a density gradient and carried out an ultracentrifugation, leading to a separation of all particles or soluble particles of the brain homogenates according to the particle size. Now, because now we have all kind of proteins and stuff in the fractions, we needed to have another assay to determine the oligomer concentration. And for this kind of measurement, we have developed an SFIDA assay. And this works like this. Biochemical setup is like a sandwich ELISA. So we start with a glass surface and immobilize anti-A-beta antibody on the glass surface. Then we add our sample, and it contains A-beta oligomers and monomers, of course, and all will be captured to the antibodies on the surface. And next we add detection probes, again, anti-A-beta antibodies labeled with green or red fluorescence dyes. And because they have an overlapping or the identical epitope for recognizing A-beta, they will decorate only the oligomers, because the epitope of the monomers is already busy with the capture antibody. Now we scan the surface, and that's the difference to a sandwich ELISA. We scan the surface, for example, with a laser scanning microscope, and then each time the laser focus hits such a highly decorated aggregate, it will lead to an fluorescence intensity burst in the green and in the red channel simultaneously. And by doing this, we simply count single oligomers, and that makes the assay maximal sensitive for oligomers, basically single particle sensitivity, and it's absolutely insensitive to A-beta monomers. By doing this SFIDA analysis to all the fractions of the density gradient separated brain homogenates, we were able to find high oligomer concentration shown in red in the placebo-treated mice, mostly in fractions 9 and 10. And this is very significantly reduced after the treatment, after oral treatment with pre-O2, shown with the blue bars. Now, why do we now find the oligomers infections 9 and 10, not anymore in 4, 5, and 6. Very obviously, there are other proteins around, and therefore the oligomers are covered also with other proteins like PRP, ApoE, and therefore the particles are larger in size. Next, we did also a so-called ex vivo target engagement, because the brains of transgenic mice contain very high concentrations of oligomers. When we go back, you see several hundreds of picomolar of oligomers. And in order to have more realistic experimental definitions, we then used brain homogenates from human tissue from former Alzheimer patients. And ex vivo, we treated them with buffer or with controlled peptides or with PreO2, and then applied the homogenates to the S-FIDA analysis. What we find is shown here, and that's maybe a little bit of a busy slide, but you see here after 24 hours treatment with just buffer, there is no big difference in the oligomer concentration, which is now in the range of a few picomolar, actually. And then we used as a control a d-enantiomeric peptide called D1 that is binding A-beta fibrils. And you see that there is no significant difference after 24 hours. And we used also a totally A-beta independent peptide QB37, also 20 micromolar. And also there is no big difference after 24 hours. But you see with 5 and 20 micromolar of PreO2 incubated, the concentration of A-beta oligomers is significantly reduced. And if we look at this independently, and that's shown here, you see that there is a clear dependence of the oligomer elimination from the PreO2 concentration on and from incubation time. And that is maybe already a hint to a catalytic activity of PreO2. Here the same for another brain homogenate from another patient with higher concentrations of A-beta oligomers, but basically the same result also here after 24 hours. In the last transgenic mouse model, we used the TBA2 mouse model. And that's a very interesting mouse model because, as I told you in the beginning, this mouse model develops neurodegeneration. And because also motor neurons are dying, you can apply very easy to do and longitudinally to do experiments, and one of them is called Shilpa, and these tests have been developed for movement disorders in mice. So, for example, ALS mouse models or Huntington mouse models. And what the test is doing, there is a blinded experimenter, and the experimenter will score mostly reflexes. With 0 when it's normal, or with up to 3 points if it's extremely abnormal or missing. So the higher the Shilpa score is, the more progressed is the motor neurodegenerative phenotype. And you can do this in contrast to a Walter Morris maze, which you can do only once. Longitudinally, we treated over 3 months, again orally, and we did Shilpa testing at baseline, in the middle of the treatment, and at the end of the treatment. And the result is shown here. You can nicely see wild type, whether treated or not, is staying close to 0 with the Shilpa score. That's how it should be, because they behave normal. And that's also a good check for the blindedness of the experimenter. And also you can see that the transgenic placebo group develops very rapidly motor neurodegenerative phenotype. And this is very, very significantly decelerated with oral treatment of PreO2. Now, all these transgenic mouse models are expressing human A-beta at very high concentrations in order to develop pathology during their short lifetime. And therefore, it was interesting to us to see whether PreO2 is also efficient in a non-transgenic model of Alzheimer's disease, which more resembles the spontaneous variant of Alzheimer's disease, not the transgenic familial version of AD. And one of the models you can have for this kind of AD model is the so-called cognitively impaired old beagle dogs. And what we have done here is, actually that was done at a CRO in the near of Toronto. We have recruited, like in a clinical study, we have recruited out of a cohort of 200 or 300 dogs, 36 dogs that were old and that were cognitively impaired. And these 36 dogs have been randomized into three groups, placebo, low dose, and high dose. And the treatment duration was over 3 months, again, orally, once daily, orally. And we did a cognitive testing every month. Then we ended treatment and we carried out cognitive testing for another 2 months. That's then the so-called washout period. And the test we've done two tests actually, and one I will show you, that's the delayed non-matching to position assay. And maybe in the interest of time, I will not go too deep into this. It basically measures in the dogs something like short-term memory. And here is shown the DNMP accuracy. The higher the accuracy is, the better the dogs are doing in this test. And it is shown here for placebo at baseline after 1, 2, 3 months, and also for the low dose and the high dose group. You can see that all the groups have kind of a practicing effect in the first 2 months, and it becomes only significant better than at baseline in the low and in the high dose group. But that's maybe not so impressive, but during the washout period, this kind of improvement of DNMP stayed at the high level it had at the end of the treatment. And that clearly suggests, or the maintenance of the DNMP accuracy suggests, a truly disease-modifying neuroprotective effect of the treatment. So the summary, I think we can skip. Next, we went into humans. And of course, in humans, you have to start with a phase 1 study to show safety in humans. And we had to do this with healthy volunteers. We used 5 cohorts of a total of 40 volunteers. And in each cohort, 6 were treated with the compound and 2 were treated with placebo. So it was a double-blind placebo-controlled study. We started with 4 milligrams per volunteer and increased then to 12, 36, 108, and finally 320 milligrams per volunteer. One treatment, that's called a single ascending dose. And very importantly, we could confirm the nice pharmacokinetic data so that the terminal half-life is longer than 24 hours of the orally applied compound. But also, of course, very importantly, a single oral dose of PreO2 led in the volunteers to compound levels in the blood, in the plasma, that was as high as it was measured in the highest dosed animal studies. And also very importantly, there have been no drug-related adverse events. Next, we did a multiple ascending dose study in healthy volunteers. And here we could show that even a 4 weeks treatment with daily 320 milligram per volunteer was safe and well tolerated. And also from the pharmacokinetic point of view, there have been no restrictions for further drug development. Now, to summarize the properties of PRIO-02, it's an orally available compound. It is blood-brain barrier penetrable. It has a new and I think absolutely unique mode of action to directly eliminate A beta oligomer, to disassemble them. This mode of action we call antipreonic. Target engagement has been demonstrated in vitro, ex vivo, in vivo. And the proof of concept has been shown in 4 different animal models in 4 different laboratories. And also the phase 1 study yielded clean safety and a comfortable pharmacokinetic profile. And I have to thank for the funding of this development project. The money came from the Helmholtz Association, from the Research Center Jülich, and the Alzheimer's Association funded the biggest part of the MAD part of the phase 1 study. Now I come back to my disclosures, and here you can find that I'm co-founder of the company PRIOvoid. And this company is founded or was founded to further to bring the program further. And you see here the summary of the spin-off company is located in Düsseldorf, Germany. And you see here the supervisory board with my dear colleagues Detlef Riesner and Stanley Prusiner, and the best management team you can dream of. And since actually a few days only, we have the necessary investment and funding to carry out a phase 2 study, a proof of concept study in humans, and also to transfer the antipreonic mode of action to other target proteins like tau, alpha-synuclein, TDP43, and so on. I have to thank many, many people to come that far. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for the great talk. We already have questions lined up from the audience. Christian has a couple of them. While we are waiting for, oh, Christian, please, you're already in.
Okay. Very nice talk, Dieter. So I have actually written down 3 questions during the time that you talked. And I just read them. It's quite curious that the resonances of a beta monomer vanish when the peptide binds. You explain it with this fuzzy 1-to-1 complex. Fuzzy would then mean that those resonances that vanish have to exchange on a slow time scale. If it was a 1-to-1 complex, then in principle with dynamic light scattering, one should be able to see it in order to distinguish it from that it just precipitates the A beta, and that would also lead to a disappearance of the NMR signals. So I wonder whether you did do this control experiment.
Thanks for the question. Then maybe I was misunderstandable. The not changing the chemical shifts that confirms the existence of a fuzzy complex. The disappearance of the peaks, obviously, can be explained by a co-precipitation. And this was measured at 40 micromolar A-beta, and it just forms, really co-precipitates. But the 1-to-1 complex and other non-1-to-1 stoichiometries that we have clearly determined in the analytical ultracentrifugation experiments that are much more sensitive and more exact than light scattering or something like this.
Okay. Should I continue with my questions?
I don't mind.
Yes, okay. yes, please. You have multiple of them.
Okay. So the next question I have was on the kinetics. I mean, you mentioned this aggregation kinetics, and you in which a substoichiometric amount of the peptide was increasing the lag phase quite dramatically. Now, you mentioned also that the peptide binds to the monomer with an 8 nanomolar concentration. So that should be a quite tight complex, such that I would expect that one could then see what is still aggregation able, a beta monomer, by just diluting and seeing what is the concentration at which one can reproduce this prolongation of the lag phase. Is that a factor? I mean, you mentioned this factor 3, also the Hill factor 3. So would it be that if you go down by a factor of 4 in the concentration, that then you reproduce the aggregation kinetics that you observe in the presence of the peptide with full concentration of a beta?
I think one has to distinguish between the experiments that need really high micromolar concentrations, because they are always co-precipitation happens. Mm. And when we look at the THT aggregation, also there we have unphysiologically high concentrations, but maybe not that high as in the NMR experiments, for example. But even then, the interaction, even if it's in the low nanomolar range, there is still dissociation and association. Mm. And over time, each compound can interact with many A-beta molecules and stabilizing them in their monomer IDP conformation. So this, I would say, can be explained by a clearly substoichiometric ratio, so that even only a 5% addition of the compound is decelerating the or prolonging the lag phase drastically.
Maybe continuing on that, did you try to look, I mean, when you have higher concentrations, to look at the composition of this precipitate? I mean, maybe determining the stoichiometry between the peptide and the A-beta?
Yeah, we have tried this, of course, but you can find there almost any ratio. Okay. So there is no fixed stoichiometry. And this we really can also see in the AUC and in the analytical algebra centrifugation, where when we over-titrate a beta, when it's fluorescence labeled with the compound, then we observe fluorescence species of a beta that have bound several molecules of the compound, and vice versa. If we fluorescence label the compound and add a beta in excess, then we observe also the other way around. So there is no fixed stoichiometry, and that also would fit to a fuzzy complex with a high association and dissociation rate.
And if I may, with my last question, maybe it's confidential and I'm not sure whether you can answer it. But do you know what is the concentration of the peptide in human brain? I mean, assuming that maybe the uptake is similar to mouse.
In humans, we don't know yet. We will know, I think, soon from patient treatments, because with the healthy volunteers, we were not allowed to take CSF.
But I guess you have determined it in the mouse models.
Yes, in the mouse. Yeah, that's also published actually. So that's not confidential. Okay. Yeah. So there, we have a really high penetration.
So the plasma level and the brain level is similar, or how is it active transport or is it passive transport? Or I mean, is that known?
We think we have investigated this in much more detail with a lead compound, which is kind of similar. And there we have shown and also published many years ago that it's probably an HIV TAT-like mechanism that makes the compound membrane penetrable. And therefore it also enters the brain. Of course, not as fast as caffeine, but after 1 or 2 hours, it penetrates the blood-brain barrier.
Okay, thanks.
Sure.
Bingzi, you can ask your questions. I see that you're on.
Hi, Dr. Wilbur, very exciting translational study, very exciting. So I have a couple of questions. First, this is a D amino acid peptide-based A beta inhibitor. Is this specific for A beta? How does the sequence similar to the A beta peptide? Does it inhibit other amyloids such as tau or IAPP?
It is specific for A beta, and it is not containing any sequence resembling the A beta sequence. So it's really selected from a mirror image phage display, at least a lead compound, and then this lead compound was optimized for A beta monomer binding. I would not expect too much of efficacy for other protein aggregates, and therefore, I mean, what we started a couple of years already ago to do the same kind of compound development for alpha-synuclein tau and tau monomers. And what we find there, and this I can tell you, is that the compounds work at least in vitro exactly like this, but they have totally different sequences, of course, because they need to have a different specificity.
The second question I have is that, so you mentioned this inhibitor convert oligomer to monomer, make it non-toxic. Does this inhibitor also have you tested convert to mature A-beta fiber to oligomer?
Well, fibrils are really stable. We have done some preliminary studies on fibrils, but so far, because we are not really interested in dissolving fibrils in potentially toxic and highly mobile oligomers, we are quite happy with the fact that obviously the compound is almost not changing the plaque pathology. Only when we treat in this study with the old aged mice, when we treated very long, 12 weeks, there we found a slightly significant reduction of plaque pathology in the cortex. But in all the other mouse studies, we have not seen significant reduction of plaque pathology, and we are really happy with this.
Yeah, okay. So I guess you answered my third question as well. I was just thinking about, you showed the neural behavior change with the treatment. And I guess you probably have done a neuropathology study, also look at the plaque of A beta plaque in the mouse brain, see whether that is a significant reduction with the treatment.
Yeah, and as I said, only in the very long treated, high dosed, old aged mice, we found a significant reduction of plaque pathology in the cortex. And in all the other studies, we did not find a significant reduction, probably because fibrils are just so stable. Mm-hmm. And actually for our intention to treat, the plaques are not a target to dissolve.
Why do you choose the aged dog? Any special consideration?
Yeah, for aged dogs, it is well known that they have cognition deficits, and it is also published and known that the underlying pathology can be, not in all cases, but can be amyloid pathology. The dogs do not have tau pathology, but they have a beta pathology, and cognitive impairment. Just to give you a rough percentage, let's say 50-60% of the dogs are cognitively impaired due to Alzheimer pathology, and the rest is cognitively impaired to any other reason.
But it's
a non-transgenic animal model, and for this we were really happy.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I see Bina. Bina, you're next. If you can unmute yourself.
Hey, thanks for that lovely talk. I have more of a clarification as my first question. So the peptide binds to the monomer and you see a reduction in the oligomer concentration. So does it mean that the peptide kind of soaks up the monomer and therefore as a function of time, you don't see any further increase in the oligomer concentration? Is that the way it works?
No, I would not say that there is, as I discussed with Christian in the beginning already, there is not a totally stable one-to-one complex between the D-peptide and A-beta. And therefore, there is no reason to think that there is a, that the compound could be consumed during the oligomer disassembly. Actually, that's not the case. So it can disassemble probably many oligomers in at a certain time.
So if you do the experiment starting only with the oligomers, then you would see a binding event, isn't it? I mean, I thought that in your initial part of the study, you said that it is selectively binding only to the monomer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really good question. Yeah. Of course, we have also thought about this. And for our mode of action, we may be kind of lucky because the compound, the D-peptide, is binding actually preferably to A-beta monomers. But in an oligomer, you have many A-beta building blocks in the oligomer, and that makes the local concentration of the A-beta molecules very high. And therefore, the compound has, due to the high local concentration, interacts indeed very affine with oligomers. But by interacting with the oligomers, it already destabilizes the oligomer.
Okay. I have just one more question. So in the beginning, you mentioned that the peptide, A-beta peptide concentration is in nanomolar range, and definitely it's kinetically not a favorable situation for oligomerization. So do we know what is the half-life of the peptide? So usually AD starts showing up in as you age. So is it that the A-beta concentration now increases as you grow older? Or is it that there is, accumulation of A-beta with time and then, as you mentioned, you give enough time and then after a certain age, you have enough concentration built up as a function of time and therefore you start seeing the aggregation happen?
I doubt that whether this is really known, but what is known is that the A-beta concentration in CSF of AD patients is decreasing, and that's the most important biomarker actually. A longitudinal decrease of A-beta total in CSF. So when you look at CSF, A-beta concentration is decreasing, and that is explained usually because A-beta is not secreted anymore into CSF and then cleared somehow, but is more and more deposited in plaques. But I would say this happens only after, way after formation of the first oligomers.
Okay, one last question. Since it's a D-peptide, and let's say, you form a complex to, have an inhibition, how is it cleared from the system? Do we know anything about it? How does the clearance mechanism works?
Not exactly. That is, of course, something we need to study and demonstrate when we progress into further clinical trial phases. But due to the high water solubility of the D-peptide, we would expect that it is cleared renally.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Sure.
I think it's 9:05, and we can meet, like move to kind of more personal session where we will allow everybody who wants to directly ask the questions into the panel. I actually see a couple of questions from anonymous attendees, but I see that Bikash also wants to ask questions. So I'll let you, Bikash, ask you, and after that, I'll read anonymous attendee questions. Bikash, do you have a question?
I think it's... Because you are muted, you're not audible. Because we cannot hear you. Okay, can I ask a question meanwhile? Magda?
Oh yeah, I'm here.
Great talk, great theater, I loved it. So very nice.
Well, thank you.
And congratulations on this. Fantastic.
Thank you.
D-peptide. So it looks like it's binding to monomers selectively, and then it also binds to oligomer and then clears the oligomers as well, based on your explanation. So we know that it's also working in vivo. That's great. So we know in the in vivo condition, there are a variety of oligomers, metal bound, lipid bound, and other types of oligomers. So if it's able to bind to oligomers and clear them off, how effective they are with the variety of oligomers present in the in vivo condition? Do you expect any challenges there?
That's a real big advantage of our mode of action, because we stabilize A beta monomers. The compound is practically independent of the conformation of the various oligomer types, because it will make them disassemble into monomers, because that's what the compound is stabilizing. And this is a big advantage over, for example, antibodies that recognize a specific conformation, because after a while you might have strains that are resistant to the antibody. And this cannot happen with our mode of action.
I see. For example, do you have any data, in vitro data, to show that it can destabilize metal-bound oligomers or lipid-bound oligomers?
No, we have not checked this.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bikash, go ahead. Yeah, question.
I think, Rams, you already asked the question that I intended to ask. I was about to ask, like, if like they have tested like zinc-bound oligomer and like kind of like GM1 bound oligomer that has been extensively studied in this. But yeah, I think I got my answer.
Okay, Magda, you have many others lined up.
Oh, so the questions which we have about the from anonymous speakers, they are already answered. In fact, they are about the binding of the compound to the monomer. But there is one kind of more specific, why are the two colors used in the S-feeder for the detection for the assay which you showed for detection? Why are two colors?
I didn't explain at all. We use usually two colors. Of course, we can use also one or three or four. But in the standard S-FIDER approach, we use two colors just to make the assay more specific, because then we will detect only oligomers that are bound by the capture antibody and by two different detection antibodies. So this makes the assay extremely specific, and this is important because we are measuring actually down to the one digit femtomolar range. So for these picomolar concentrations you have seen on the slides, we had to dilute the samples.
Okay, yeah, thank you. That's really interesting. I have a question which is more about administration of the compound. I know that you're still working on that, but so how do you envision to be administered? Just chronically taken for as long as the people are living, or do you see reoccurrence upon let's say one time dosage treatment in animals? All of these logistics of moving forward to the real life.
So currently we did all the animal and the human treatments with once daily oral dosing. Mm-hmm. For example, in the dog study, we did this kind of a washout experiment. So we stopped treatment and went on with cognition assays. And there we could see that if you compare it to a painkiller, for example, if you treat someone with a painkiller, the pain will be reduced. But if you do not treat the reason for the pain, then stopping the painkiller treatment will bring back the pain. And that's a typical non-causal treatment. And in our dog study, we can nicely see that we do observe a really disease-modifying treatment. And we would explain it like this, that oligomers are around in the brain and are interfering with synapses and with neuron activity. And if this is the case and you get rid of the oligomers, you can principally bring back the functionality to the neuron network and make the synapses becoming functional again. So from that point of view, it might be possible, to be really cautious, it might be possible to have a certain time of treatment and then stop the treatment if all oligomers are disassembled. So there is possibly no need for a lifelong treatment. But the good thing is our compound is obviously so safe that a lifelong treatment would be possible. I mean, we call it antibryonic in parallel to an antibiotic compound. And also for antibiotics, you would never think about lifelong treatment, right?
Yeah. That's natural. Yeah, that is really impressive if you can achieve that. Do you have an idea of a timeline, like a year or two or... any sense on that, or this is just something which is in the works? Or
we of course have very concrete detailed plans for the phase two, but I think I'm not allowed to
The other question which I have is about you got the questions about that, but optimization of the compound. Did you choose that compound for its highest affinity or for its solubility or penetrance? I assume it's a mix of everything, because it's, you don't want to entirely shut down A beta monomer and A beta. It does some functions which are important. So the best type of treatment, I assume, is just something which is the Goldilocks rule, just a little bit. Is that the case in that compound, or?
I would say yes, because unlike an antibody, which binds the target, let's say a monomer, basically forever, until the antibody is degraded and together with the beta moiety, possibly, our compound is not doing anything to the beta monomer. So it can have its functionality if there is a physiologic function. And because the interaction is transient. So if there is a physiological function of A-beta, I think it can be fulfilled. And of course the same is even more important for the other targets where there is a known function for alpha-synuclein and tau. And for these targets, it is crucial not to take away every monomer that has been folded back from an oligomer. So that's really a very important feature of our mode of action and the compounds that we realize the mode of action.
And you've been mentioning, and this is something we focus on the A-beta, and it's very good that you're also considering alpha-synuclein and tau and TDP-43. But for example, even for the Alzheimer's disease, you have tau pathology, and it's always been which one comes first and so forth. And recent, studies just like everybody showed that like tau pathology actually correlates with the phenotype. So the regions in the brain patients, and this is done with the imaging, like regions in the brains which are affected by tau pathologies are the ones which are like phenotypically connected in the brain. So what are your take homes here? Are you planning of using the two compounds? How is it going? I know that also A-beta is the one which it's like patients with A-beta can live without any cognitive decline. The minute tau pathology starts appearing, it's dead. Mm-hmm. So all of that is like, do you, I mean, it may be proprietary, but what group of patients are you targeting? Like with a mild cognitive impairment or more advanced, considering all of we know now about tau and A-beta? Sorry.
Yeah, the MCI patients due to AD, or the patients with MCI due to AD, are certainly the most wanted patient group by basically all the antibody treatment studies. This is certainly also for our compound an interesting cohort, but for our readout at the end of the study, it is important to be at least able to measure some improvement of cognition. And for this, of course, there has to be already a certain degree of decline, not too much, of course. So that is something which makes us thinking about also recruiting mild AD patients. But this is something what we decided already. I cannot tell you, I'm not allowed to tell you, but this is basically the thoughts one would have looking at the compound's properties in animals and the expected outcomes in clinical trials.
Yeah, thank you. That's because it's kind of complex because of the two pathologies. I see that Long Cheng is on the line. Long, do you want to ask questions?
Yeah, actually, my question is for your question. I feel excited because the new paper come out to validate the cascades, which is a tau pathology in the AD model. Actually, it's induced by the neuroinflammation, which is caused by A-beta. So I just wondering, it seems like this compound can bind to the A-beta monomer, and also you mentioned it can also reduce neuroinflammation. I just wonder if this compound is applied to the, for example, the 3TG mouse model, which has both A-beta and the tau pathology. Then I just like would imagine maybe in that model, finally you might have a milder tau pathology because you have reduced A beta, you have reduced neuroinflammation. That's upstream of the cascade. So I just wondering, do you have any thoughts about this? Yeah,
thank you for the question. That's of course extremely interesting, but like many things are interesting to check, but that's certainly on the list to treat mixed pathology models.
And my second question is, this compound specific bind to the monomer A beta, and whether this compound also can bind to the APP, the C-terminal truncation portion, which also saw to be get involved to the toxic mechanism to by reduce the cell integrity. That's the delete C-terminal of APP before the A beta generation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is of course a very obvious question we needed to address during the development, and because we would expect that the compound is also binding to APP because it contains the A beta part, we were only kind of anxious whether the compound is interfering with beta and gamma secretase activity, for example, or alpha secretase. And that we have checked, and there is no interference with any of the secretases we have tested.
Yeah. And my third question is, this compound is bound to the monomer. Also, do they can break down the longer or different lengths, the oligomeric? That means my concern is, at some time point, you may be in general reduce oligomer resistance concentration, but you might also generate more shorter oligomer rather than longer oligomer. And you're not complete reduce the monomer to turn the oligomer to the monomer. Instead, you might generate a more shorter oligomer, so which might also toxic as well. So what's your thought about that? Thank you.
Kind of difficult question, because we do not know how oligomers look like. We do not even know whether they are short and long. So, I mean, they are larger and smaller, certainly. But whatever we look at in experiments, we can simply measure the decrease in total A-beta oligomer concentration. We have at least not tried, and I think there are no real good methods around to watch a decreasing size of oligomers while it is disassembled. And I doubt very much whether we would be able to observe this, because I think it's a highly cooperative process, the disassembly of the oligomers. And because as I tried to explain in this oversimplified scheme in the beginning, the oligomer is destabilized by interaction of the compound with single building blocks within the oligomer, and at the end it is disassembled into monomers or not, and yeah, decreasing the size, I think, yeah, it would be extremely difficult to show.
Thank you for very much.
Thank you very much for the great talk and the nice session. Rams and John, do you have
somebody has raised the hand? I think Bina, I think.
Oh, Bina, do you have questions? I'm sorry.
Martin,
yes. If there is time, may I ask a question?
Yeah. Is it okay with you?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
You know, it's such a promising molecule. I was just, and I know this is a difficult experiment, but I was just wondering, since it has such good PKPDs, is there a way to test that in early stage AD, if such a treatment is given, would it, you know, delay the severity of the disease? Is there a way to test that?
Yeah, I think this would be even the easier task. Therefore, all the other drug candidates in the different pipelines are looking for patients as early as possible, and maybe even patients that do not have any cognition signs are the most wanted, because they all hope that inhibiting something will be certainly is beneficial for the treated people. That's for sure. But for proving and to get a market, to get the drug to the market, you have to prove that it is efficient. And people or patients that have no cognitive decline yet, but amyloid and tau pathology, they have a very slow decline in their neurodegeneration and in cognition. So these are the patient groups you need to treat and watch over years. And therefore, there is this this balancing between the how far progressed the disease is. The farther progressed it is, the faster is the decline of the patients, and the less you need to treat the patients for any potential treatment effect. So this is the way you have to think by designing the treatment trials, phase two and phase three. But I would expect that any drug that is efficient in patients, cognitively declined patients, would do even much better in preventive studies.
Great. Thanks.
Sure.
Can I ask a question?
Oh yeah, Rams, please.
So you mentioned about A beta oligomer being larger in the presence of ApoE or PRP1, or what is the protein name?
Yeah, prion protein is one
PRP, yeah. So could you give me more details on that? Because you didn't mention anything beyond that.
There are some publications out that claim already PRP bound or ApoE bound to A beta aggregates. And that's an ongoing study in my academic lab to really investigate this in an unbiased way. So we look by mass spectroscopy, for example, for any interaction partners of the A beta oligomers from brain homogenates. And some of the proteins we have already identified quite certainly. And then the next step is then to look for or to validate these interactions with S-FIDA, for example. If we use a third color, for example, for the prion protein or for ApoE, we should be able to easily identify and validate these kind of interactions. But I think this needs some more time to be addressed.
Very nice. Thank you.
Sure.
I really like also, just before I let you go, I really like the idea how you treat the brain tissue with your compound. So these are frozen brain tissues, which you treat and after that you analyze, right?
Yeah, and of course we do the homogenization and then centrifuge everything big and fibrils away. So we really have only soluble parts of the brain, and there we find very robustly, and this will be published soon, picomolar concentrations of oligomers in the homogenates, and actually most of the healthy brain donors not.
Yeah, it's really exciting. We're looking forward to publication. Let me ask if John wants to ask a question. John.
No, it was a fantastic talk, though. Thank you so much. And thank you for staying longer to answer questions.
Yeah, sure. It was keeping you, but it's such an exciting area. And hopefully it will work well in the stage two and three trials.
We will take the chance. Yeah.
Yeah. It's really, really exciting, and cross my fingers.
So is this compound available for other labs to investigate, or still it's...
It for academics, I think everybody can have it. You can just order it with your peptide manufacturer.
Okay.
The sequence is published. So there's absolutely, it is just patent protected for commercial use.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
I have one question. So may I?
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
So I was just looking at the peptide sequence because he just mentioned to RAM. So it looks like this peptide RG2 has like penta-arginine at the C-terminus, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like I was wondering, like if you look at the interaction pattern, it gives me an impression that amyloid beta in physiological pH is has a negatively charge of -3, right? And most of the acidic residues are present in the N-terminus.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks like your peptide is more likely to interact electrostatically to the A-beta monomers in the N-terminus, right? But from your HSQC spectra, if I remember correctly, it looks like you don't see any changes in those acidic residues, right? So do you have any kind of like idea in your mind, like where exactly it binds? Because in oligomers, it looks like if you look at the literature, so like one of the hypotheses in oligomer is that your hydrophobic residue is exposed and your N terminus is somehow protected. So I cannot imagine like how this compound is actually working for both oligomer and oligomer at the same time.
Working for the oligomers, as you call it, is really enhanced by the fact that the local concentration of the monomer building blocks in the oligomer is so high. So even with a low affinity for a single not IDP monomer building block in the oligomer, you will achieve, due to the high local concentration of the remaining monomers at the end, a very high affinity to oligomers. But as I said, while interacting with the oligomers, it's already destabilizing them. And the first part of your question, whether the N-terminus is maybe more attractive for the compound, I would have guessed so. We can not see in the NMR spectra any sign on this. So it's obviously very transient and it's transiently interacting with all parts of A-beta, obviously, from that point of view. And what has been done is molecular dynamics simulations. And there, a former speaker of our institute, Birgit Strodel, maybe she even talked about this a little bit. She did a simulation with a compound and simulated oligomers. And there she found hints that the compound is indeed first approaching the N-terminus and the acidic residues, but then it interacts with the remaining A-beta molecule as well.
Because I think one of your slide, you have shown that the condition that you are using, I think 20 millimolar phosphate buffer with 50 millimolar of salt, which is not a physiological concentration. So do you have any data where you studied with a salt gradient to see how this interaction between your peptide having penta-arginine at the end is actually affecting its interaction with your A-beta? Do you have any salt gradient data?
Salt gradient, sorry, I think I didn't get the question.
Like if you increase the ionic strength, so if it is like mediated by the electrostatic interaction,
you should expect
that there is a decrease in binding affinity from 8 nanomolar to some kind of micromolar or something like that.
Yes. Of course. The more salt in the solution for the experiments, for the binding experiments, the more, the less is the affinity. Yes, of course. Because it is partially based on the charged residues.
Yeah, because your THT data, you use 50 millimolar of salt. So is there any concern on the salt or why you choose 50 millimolar rather than using like physiological concentration?
Actually, I don't know. We have optimized the assays also to keep as much of the A-beta in solution when we used high concentrations. So therefore, that this is also strongly salt dependent and you cannot measure what you want to measure if you precipitate A-beta immediately with high salt.
May I ask one more question about the brain lysate experiment? Thank you. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really cool. We mentioned the human brain tissue lysate using the FIDA assay and to show the oligomer reduction. And I wonder, maybe I missed, so you have the mouse model treated with compound, you show the behavior score is rescued. Do you use the same brain tissue lysate to do the same FIDA assay? to check the whether or not the oligomer also reduction. I think that will be the evidence to show the compound is hit the right target in the mouse model.
You want to like show in the...
Yeah, because you divide the FIDAIC to show the oligomer reduction. So at least you use the human brain tissue lysate, add the compound in vitro, and you see the oligomer reduction. Mm-hmm. So my question, do you use same strategy apply to your mouse model with oligomer?
Yeah, actually, we have done this even before we used the human brain samples. Yeah, that worked really nice and actually even better because the mice do have much higher concentrations of oligomers, at least a factor of 10, sometimes to 100 more oligomer concentration.
My second question, that's awesome. Is that means it's durable for the FIDIC if I can use a different antibody that I can detect a different form for like A beta or modified A beta, even tau, right?
Right. And that we also do that we simultaneously measure A beta oligomers and tau oligomers in samples, for example, homogenates, brain homogenates, or CSF or plasma. So this we have done, and it can be done actually with any combination you want to address. You simply have to use other antibodies as detection probes.
Is this a protocol published or not yet?
The principle is published. So we have published some papers, at least 10, in maybe 2010 to 2014, 15. In the meanwhile, we have very much progressed with the SFIDA assay to make it really much more reliable and robust. And that's awesome.
Yeah, that's great. We will try. Thank you so much.
Well, you got disconnected.
Yeah, I think we got disconnecting. Wolfgang, thank you so much for introducing this.
Yeah, thank you so much, Wolfgang. Are you there?
Yeah, thank you for having me. That was great.
Mm-hmm. It looks like you're not disconnected. It was a great talk. You guys are rocking there. The compound is doing so much wonder. So I wanted to ask him, he has five arginine, so highly positively charged. I would expect it to be antimicrobial as well. Is that compound antimicrobial? I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, this you really have to ask Dita.
So
I can't answer that question.
Maybe we can conclude and we can send an email to him, thanking him. Magda.
I think that's the end of it.
Oh yeah, send me an email asking. Sorry, battery is off. Okay, I'm going to say. Thank you, no problem.
Mm-hmm. Interesting that the sound problem was only occurring during the presentation, right? And not when you answered the questions.
Yeah, I think, I don't know why it was, the modulation was, the audio was going up and down very, sometimes, not always.
I think it stabilized the audio. And I have a feeling that probably his microphone was moving while he was talking. And that's why.
That should not be a problem, right? It should be able to pick up the.
Yeah.
And he was not moving so much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. Thank you so much for coming. And it's really exciting research.
Yeah, let's hope for the phase two.
I already said
the results that all want to see.
Yeah, so I already sent him an email saying that no worries, thanks very much, we'll be in touch. So let's say bye for now. Thank you very much, Wolfgang, for everything, and thanks, Magda. Thanks.
Thank you, Ron.
Thanks to all the participants, they're all still here. So, thanks very much.
Bye.
Encourage your cohorts to participate.
Bye-bye.
Wolfgang, encourage your group to participate. Ask them to submit abstract and video for.
Yeah.
You got that, right?
Sure, we already did that. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we already did that. We motivated them a lot.
Okay, so if we he is back here. Oh, welcome back.
Sorry, the battery went off. I don't know why.
It was a great talk. We all enjoyed lots of great questions. You answered very patiently and nicely. Thanks very much.
So I would have answered last question. Any more questions?
Yeah. You have like five arginines. I would expect it to be antimicrobial. Is this antimicrobial peptide as well, this compound?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay. Is it selective to gram negative or gram positive?
Oh, we have not checked this. It has just disturbed our Ames test for the, you know, safety, preclinical safety. And therefore, we know, only therefore, we have, in the Ames test, you check for genotoxicity, yep. And our outcome was kind of strange. And in the end, we found it's antibacterial, yeah.
Can be also anti-cancer too, I don't know. Because the cancer cell similar to bacterial cells, right? It has more negatively charged lipids as well as glycoproteins, which are negatively charged. So you could test that. And I'm wondering that if you have the monomer A beta and this compound bound complex, if it becomes more antimicrobial or more anti-cancer, I don't know. This is something to test.
Yeah.
Great talk. Loved it. So we would like to post this, your talk in YouTube channel. Are you okay with that?
Yeah.
Okay. And then your audio, I'm sorry, your audio did go up and down in between. But in the Q&A session, it was awesome. No problem at all.
Okay.
Very good. You're okay with that? No problem, right? Because audio was sometimes really, it was audible, but one has to be careful in hearing that.
Okay. Yeah. It sometimes happens. I don't know why. I found it that sometimes your own loudspeaker makes a back.
But we all muted.
Checking.
But we muted our audios.
Yeah, then I cannot explain it.
Like for a Q&A, we all have the audio open, but it works fine, no problem.
Okay.
All right, thank you very much. And danke schön, auf Wiedersehen to you all.
Both sehr gerne. Auf Wiedersehen. Tschüss.
Bye. Tschüss.
Bye-bye.
Ja, tschüss, Dieter. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Tschüss, Wolfgang. Schönes Wochenende.